Hello, my name is Ambrose. Welcome to Ambrose King Online House Fellowship. We give our life a lifting through the Word of God. Today I'm going to be talking about repentance, which is the walking of the Holy Spirit on earth. So welcome to our online house fellowship. I hope this video is going to be, I hope this fellowship is going to be a blessing to you. So kindly comment, put your comment below about fellowship and let's fellowship together. Our primary goal is to win as many to Christ and to get believers established in Christ before the return of our Lord Jesus Christ. This topic of repentance is very important. Have you ever seen somebody who never repents, who never apologize? They always think they are always right. It's really a very bad spirit. But let's see what the Bible says. In John chapter 18 verse 8, you see, and when he come, he will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. He's talking about the Holy Spirit. See, Jesus said that when the Holy Spirit comes, the Holy Spirit is a person. We see that Jesus used the word he, a pronoun. That's why you don't look at the Holy Spirit as a dove or treat him like a dove, use him as a dove as in your logo or whatever you do. The Holy Spirit is a divine being. He's the one that created the universe and he's the one that can baptize you into Christ. If you treat the Holy Spirit as a bird or a dove, Satan will definitely take advantage of you. The Holy Spirit is a divine being, not a bird. So don't represent the Holy Spirit as a dove. Have you ever seen people represent the Holy Spirit as a dove in their logo, in their fellowship, in their flyers? I'm not here to condemn them, but the Bible tells us to judge everyone. So the Holy Spirit is a person. And Jesus said when he comes, he uses the word he. He didn't say when it come. He said he. He looks a person. You know, the reason why people treat Holy Spirit as a dove is because of the description of how he descended in Luke chapter 3 verse 22, how Luke described it. Say, and the Holy Ghost descended in a bodily shape like a dove upon him, upon Jesus. And a voice came from heaven, which said, thou art my beloved son, in thee I am well pleased. You see, it was a description on how he descended. He descended very softly and landed on Jesus. So the Holy Spirit is a person. So the Holy Spirit is the one that convinced you. Without the Holy Spirit, you won't have a repentant heart. You know, you won't be able to learn. You won't be able to grow. You will set your mind in one direction. And that one direction, if anybody doesn't agree with you or anybody corrects you, you will have problems. The Bible tells us don't correct a fool. If you correct a fool will hate you. When you try to correct some people, let them know what the Word of God says, or what is outside their view, oh, they will hate you. Some people hate you. They don't like to be corrected. You know, it's the working of the Holy Spirit that can have you repent. Repentance is simply a change of mind. You know, we have different philosophies, different worldview, different doctrines. But once you learn the truth, the Holy Spirit in you will convince you and convict you and point you to the truth. Some people know the truth, but they don't want to change. That's because they don't have the working of the Holy Spirit in their life. You know, unbelievers don't have the Holy Spirit, so that's why they hardly repent. That's why they don't quickly apologize, genuinely. A lot of times when they want to apologize, they'll tell you, don't be offended. Or in my language, in my country, they will say, no vex. See, that is no apology. That is not genuine apology. It didn't come from your bottom of your heart. When somebody tell you no vex or don't be offended, they are telling that what they are doing is right. But you, they are shifting to you that you don't be offended for what they did. But when you have the Holy Spirit, when the Holy Spirit points to the truth, you will have a change of heart, a change of mind, and point towards the truth. And that is the working of the Holy Spirit. When you treat the Holy Spirit as a bird, you will not be able to hear him when he's correcting you. But when you treat him as a person, a divine being, you'll be able to have a change of heart. The Bible tells us that in the last days that, you know, we should not be ignorant of his device, Satan's devices. Otherwise, he will take advantage of us. That's 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 11. So, repentance is a change of heart, a change of mind from your current view, and you want to embrace the truth. When you look at some people, because of their doctrine, if you try to correct them, a lot of people will be saying so many terrible things, even though they know the truth, or some cannot even receive the truth. And they will be giving you bad comments and saying so many negative things. But that's because they don't have the working of the Holy Spirit. So throughout this week, we'll be talking about the Holy Spirit. He's the creator of the universe. He's the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory. I'm going to take a text from Hebrews chapter 6, and I'm going to read verse 1. This is going to be a short fellowship, and have your Bible, cross-check, and make sure it is there. And if you have any comment, please put it in the comment section below. If you have any question, I will respond. In Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 1, I'm going to read it. It says, therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on to perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith towards God. When you look at this verse, very important verse, the Bible tells us that Jesus wants to, God wants us to be perfected. He said, let us go on to perfection. So God wants you to keep growing. God wants you to keep learning. And as you learn, you'll be having change of mind. There are so many things that I preached many, many years ago, like today, I'll be so embarrassed to preach it because they were not true. You know, I've grown, I've learned, I've studied. There are some people that I used to follow, some people that I used to travel to go and do programs, you know. But now I have learned some new stuff and I have to move on. So that is how life is. You have to come on to perfection. Have you ever seen some people that whatever they believe, they are just stuck? They can't even advance. See, God wants you to be perfected. He wants you to go into perfection. But then use the word repentance. They're not laying against the foundation of repentance. That repentance, the Greek word that was used here, is metanoia. It means a change of mind. You know, as it appears to one who repents. Once you repent, you will have a change of mind. You know, that's why some people, they are still enjoying the sin and the thing they are doing because they have not had a change of mind. They think that they will use their own efforts, or they are tired of trying, and because of that, they are just stuck. A change of mind starts from your spirit. Once you have a change of mind, then you begin to walk towards the truth. It talks about, again, repentance is metanoia. There's the Greek word that was translated to English in this verse. A change of mind, as it appears to one who repents of a purpose he has performed or formed, or if something he has done. God wants you to be perfect. So follow his instructions, follow his direction in the word. It's very simple. All you need to do is embrace the word of God. Allow the Holy Spirit into your life. He's the one that will help you to repent. And when you preach to the unbelievers, it's the Holy Spirit that convinces them. That's why we preach, you know, we preach salvation. If you do not preach salvation, you don't give them the material for the Holy Spirit to use to convince them. And that's why our primary goal is to win souls by preaching salvation, unfolding the truth of the word of God. We are not doing by our own efforts. We are not telling them to join our church or join our ministry. You know, we are doing is giving them the word. In Matthew chapter 9, I will read verse 13. Matthew 9 and verse 13. This is what Jesus says. Say, but go ye and learn what that meaneth. I will have mercy and not sacrifice. For I am not come to call the righteous, but to sinners to repentance. See, that's what Jesus did. Anytime you are preaching the true gospel, the true gospel will always convince you in your heart. And when it convinces your heart, two things will happen. If you have a bad opinion, the gospel will change your opinion. Glory to God. And if you have a good opinion, the gospel will help you to be established. That's why the Holy Spirit's working in you will help you to always repent, always to embrace what the word of God says, rather than what your doctrine says that's not correct. The Bible says in the last days, many will depart from the faith and give heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of demons. Seducing spirits are always there. They are always thrown at us. Even I have had my own fair share of seducing spirits and seducing gospel. But it is the Holy Spirit in you that will help you to be established and grounded and say, no, I'm going to do what the word of God says. No matter what, I will stick with the word. And I will not depart. You know, Jesus says there, he said, I will have mercy. Whatever you have done that is wrong, Jesus is there to have mercy for you once you have repentance. There's no amount of sin that you have committed that will deprive you of salvation. So all you need to do is have a change of heart. And that change of heart starts from your inside. It's not your own effort to change. You just have to have that change that, oh my goodness, I've been in this, under this ministry for a long time. They have lied to us, or I've been doing this, it's a lie. Now I've seen it with my eyes, I've seen the scriptures. Then the first thing is to have that change of heart, and that is what repentance is. And it's only when you have the Holy Spirit that can help you to have that change of mind. There are people that you minister to, or they've been under the doctrine of false doctrine or doctrine of demons. when you minister to them, instead of them to accept the truth, they will insult you. They will put too many stupid remarks and try to make you look bad. It's because they don't have the working of the Holy Spirit. Yet they go to church. You know, so that's why we intercede for them, that they will get saved. And until you get saved and have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit in you, you can never have repentant heart, because demons don't repent. If you don't have the Holy Spirit, you have demons. It's as simple as that. So you decide what you want, whether you want the Holy Spirit or you want demons. When you look at this verse, Matthew chapter 9, verse 13, Jesus said, "He will have mercy and not sacrifice." Very remarkable. God is not moved by your sacrificial service or sacrificial giving more than He wants you to walk in genuine repentance. So many people give for human recognition. They give because it's the preach transaction gospel. Give unto God and God will give to you. Have you ever heard they say, "Give and it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed and shaken together, run over"? So that is a transaction gospel, that if you give God money, God will give you 100-fold return. That is not the gospel of Jesus Christ. That is the gospel of Mammon. See, the verse has been twisted and has been used to take advantage of people. So that's why we need to give our heart to God. Give our heart to the word of God. You know, so many people, they think that when they give, God is in there. God is not there, because a lot of them is for human recognition. They want to get position in church. They want to be sitting in front. They will be given preferential treatment. You know, so a lot of people do that type of transactional giving. You see, and so many people give for recognition, transaction, and human reward, and their heart is far from God. Until you have the Holy Spirit in you, you cannot understand the scripture. You cannot embrace the scripture. You cannot embrace the doctrine of Christ. God, Christ. Yet God wants you to be perfected. Any doctrine outside the doctrine of Christ cannot get you perfected. God wants you to move forward. He wants to move on, but it has to come with repentance. Repentance is a system of belief that you have now, but you have a change of mind and want to accept the word of God. We are in this world. So, you know, Satan is the god of this world. So he has set up a system that a lot of people have embraced. And that system is falsehood. And if you embrace the word of God, sometimes when you hear the word of God, it's so different from what you are used to. It's so different from what you have been preached to. It's so, especially when you go to a fake church. But if you embrace what the word of God says, what the Holy Spirit says, and decide to turn to embrace it, that is repentance. And it's progressive from one step to another. You know, he wants sinners and unbelievers to repent. When you are an unbeliever, repentance will help you to embrace Christ. And when you are a believer or you go to church, you will still be growing. There are things that you knew before, the way you kind of behave. But when you know the truth, yours is to repent. Repent, that means change of mind. There are many years ago, when I first got saved, many years ago, I used to go to a church where they invite me, where they say, you know, you have to pray for your enemy to die by fire. And die. Everything is about enemy and devil and demon. But when I found out, that was what they were taught. That's what they embraced. But you embrace what Jesus said and the New Testament doctrine. It says, pray for your enemies. Pray for those who despisefully use you, because he has shown mercy to everyone. And when you pray for your enemies and not curse, you'll be heaping coals of fire on their head. But it's so difficult, especially for Africans, to embrace that doctrine of Christ. They're so used to die. Oh, my enemy die. Some assault 7 times. Die. But Jesus said, pray for them. Love everyone. So when you change your mind, you say, okay, this is what I was used to. I don't care who preaches to you. I don't care who the person is that preached to me. I want to embrace Christ. That is repentance. See, you are repenting. You know, he wants sinners to repent, and he wants believers to have a change of mind from, you know, he wants sinners to repent from serving the devil or self to serving God. That is the first step of repentance. The next step of repentance is to have a change of heart from your worldview, your philosophy, how you think, from how you think, maybe doctrinally or traditionally or culturally, to embrace the truth. And the truth of God is unfold to us gradually. It's a gradual revelation, because you cannot take the whole word of God at once. So that's why you have to, the Bible says, follow those who through faith obtain the inheritance. That's why you have to listen to people who preach the truth, people who preach the true word of God. Those who lie to you and deceive you, stop. You need to cut them automatically. Otherwise, you have not repented. It doesn't matter. I told a friend of mine who I've been following for a while, I said, cut your losses. Embrace God. Follow the truth. It doesn't say because you have been there for a long time, you want a reward. You will never get any reward. And if it's any reward you want to get, is the reward that human beings will give to you. It cannot be compared to what God will give to you. So repentance is a change of mind and embracing the truth. Now, when you look at that verse and what Jesus said in Matthew 29, verse 30, he said, I will have mercy and not sacrifice. A lot of us have been told that you have to give sacrificially. You have to do sacrificial service. You have to give until it pains you. But then God said, I'm not interested in sacrifice. He wants you to embrace the truth. The Bible said that, oh, dear Lord, you shall hear. He said the truth is what sets you free. He doesn't want to put us in bondage. He's interested in giving you mercy. And mercy is what you don't deserve. You know, he gets you saved. He wants to get you saved instead of getting destroyed and punished in hellfire. You don't deserve to go to heaven, but Jesus already died on your behalf. That is the mercy. He has mercy on you. And until you receive this salvation, the Holy Spirit cannot come and live in you. It's not possible. That's why we pray salvation a lot and want to get as many saved. Not only as get many saved, and to get believers or churchgoers to be established in the doctrine of Christ. And for you to embrace the doctrine of Christ, you have to have a repentant heart. So when you are rebellious, you are stubborn, you don't want to hear the word of God, you want to embrace the truth, you want to embrace your doctrine, and someone you are following constantly, they will mislead you and you might end up in hellfire. We don't point people to ourselves, we point people to Jesus, because we are already partaking of the divine nature of God. In John, in chapter 18 and verse 8 that I just read, I'm going to read in the New American Standard Bible, same thing as almost gives you. It says, and he, when he comes, see, they use he to describe the Holy Spirit, not it. You see, when he comes, that's why when you represent the Holy Spirit with a dove, he will not be able to embrace what he's bringing to you to purify it and to perfect you. He said, and he, when he comes, he will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment. I read the contemporary English version. He said, the Spirit will come and show the people of this world the truth about sin and God's justice and the judgment. The Holy Spirit is always at work in us. And until you listen to the Holy Spirit, you will not receive the truth. But for you to follow the Holy Spirit, you have to always have teachable spirit. You have to have humility, genuine humility, not fake humility. Genuine humility. You ask God, Lord, I want to know you. I want to know you better. I want to fellowship with you and be ready to have a change of heart for the Holy Spirit to continuously unveil things to you. Otherwise, why will he reveal things to you if you don't want to change? Some people just like where they are and they don't mind suffering and dying and going to hell. Why do you want to do that? Very soon, rapture is going to take place. The first set of rapture. And the Antichrist will be loose on this earth. And he's going to rule this earth. It's going to be horrible. Anyone that is not saved will be left behind. And they will have to face the Antichrist. He has lied. Satan has lied. The devil has lied to you all this time. Lied to so many people. And they still embrace what the devil says. So, all you need to do is learn how to embrace the truth. Repentance is a few things I put together here. Let me quickly run over it because of time. This is just going to be a short fellowship. Number one, repentance is the birth canal through which people come to the kingdom of God. Without repentance, you cannot come to the kingdom of God. And without repentance, you cannot embrace the truth. You cannot be established. That we see people come to Christ, they backslide, they go back, and are now saying back to Christ movement because they were there before, they left. But when you get saved the right way, oh, glory to God. You can backslide, you can backslide, whatever, but you will still be established in Christ. You see, repentance can be accomplished through knowledge of the truth you accept. It's the truth that you accept that will produce repentance in you. If you don't accept that truth, you will never repent. No, it's not possible. It's the only Holy Spirit that can help you. See, genuine repentance does not need emotions. Have you ever seen people cry when you pray for them? They cry, they feel so sorry. The next Sunday, you think that they will change. They didn't change. They just had emotionally feel good. Genuine repentance starts from your spirit. Oh, being sorry is not necessarily repentance. We always say not vex. Don't be offended. That's what's called non-apology. It's not an apology. They have not had repentance. Genuine repentance stands for your spirit, and you will know when somebody clearly apologized to you that it comes from them. Nowadays, a lot of people keep saying it's not vex, don't be offended. When I hear them, I just laugh with them because I know who they are already. I don't fight with them, I don't argue with them, because the word of God has already revealed who they are. So mine is to love them with the love of Christ. You know, Genuine repentance is of the heart, it's of your spirit. It's the Holy Spirit that convicts us of sin. It's the Holy Spirit that convicts us that we are doing the wrong thing. It's the Holy Spirit that convicts us that this so-called bishop, this so-called apostle, this so-called prophet, this so-called archbishop, this so-called pastor has been lied to me all this time. But now I want to embrace the truth. It's the Holy Spirit that can help you. Where is the Holy Spirit? He lives inside of you. If you do not have a teachable heart, teachable spirit, humble spirit, the Holy Spirit will not come to teach you because he knows you won't listen. Well, the Holy Spirit will use people just like me coming online every day. I don't mind coming online every day, 2 times, 3 times. You know, it's helping me. And when you hear the truth, yours is to embrace the truth. If you disagree, put a comment there. Say, no, this is a lie. Sure, I want to learn. So, Holy Spirit will help you to repent. And it's a continuous progress until Jesus returns. So you might say, how does this help me? A few things again I put together. If you are someone that always lie, you are always lying. You say negative things. You are always angry. You say one thing and you do another thing, which a lot of people do these days. They tell you one thing, but they are doing something totally opposite. Oh, dear Lord. If you are someone that, you know, very negative, you are always committing sin, adultery, fornication, lying, stealing, lust, drinking, you have problem with sins, your repentance starts from inside of you. Your genuine repentance starts from you having a change of mind and saying to yourself that you will stop. You may not be able to stop instantly, even though you say you, you know, even though you say you stop, you will still do what you do want to do, but it starts from your heart. Every time you do that thing again, you find out that your heart is pierced. You feel so sad. You will cry to God. You see, that is genuine repentance. You see, some people, they just enjoy what they are doing. They don't care. Ask the Holy Spirit to help you. Make up your mind that what you're doing is not the right thing. You cannot help it. You cannot help yourself. Ask the Holy Spirit to help you, because he's the one that will help you. You see, you still make mistakes. You still be doing the same thing even after you've repented, after you said to yourself you will change. You make mistakes. You still sin. You still do all those things. As long as you're in the flesh, you will still sin. As long as you're on this earth, you will still sin. But don't beat yourself up. Forgive yourself. You know, and say, you know, keep saying to yourself you will change. You know, godly repentance produces salvation. Once you repent and say to yourself, you don't need to talk to a man. You know, some denominations, if you sin, you have to go to a human being and tell the human being your sins, and the human will lay hands on you and say forgive you. That is a doctrine of demons. That is not of God. God is the one that can forgive sins. And once you talk to God, he will understand and he will give you that grace, because he wants to show you mercy. Repentance is a change of mind. So have a change of mind from the world system to the kingdom of God system. So be a kingdom lover. How do you be a kingdom lover? Be a word of God addict. You love the word of God. You stick with the word. Until you stick the word of God, you're still going to be a world system lover. And you are not repenting. God knows your heart. Mm-hmm. And he revealed to some of his own. He revealed to some of us who you are. So, but we are not going to condemn anyone, but we are still to judge. Understand that rapture is very close. It's knocking at the door. It's knocking. Oh my goodness. I can't say this enough. But we are going to come to preach almost every day until rapture. And I trust that the word of God will have its course in your heart. You see, the danger of not having conscience of repentance is very terrible. Some people don't have conscience. And that is so dangerous. Some people, they don't have that conscience. It's totally gone. Because anytime you submit to doctrines of demons or seducing spirit, they will take your genuine heart away. And they'll give you a heart of stone. A heart of stone don't have repentance. They feel good. They can murder people and don't feel good. They can rape women and don't even feel good. They can take advantage of you and don't feel good. And you still see them in church. That's because they have a stony heart. Repentant, you know, to have repentant heart, you have to have a teachable spirit. And you have to ask God, Father, give me teachable spirit. Father, I am submitted to you. He's the creator of the universe. And if you're watching me today, you are not yet saved. Your heart is already a heart of stone. I'm not insulting you. It's the truth. You may not know. But when you hear the gospel that Jesus died for all of your sins, and you refuse to submit to Jesus, it's called heart of stone. Until you have the Holy Spirit, you may not be able to have a genuine repentance. So if you're watching me today, you're not saved, or you go to church. I call them churchgoers. I don't call them believers. A lot of people are just churchgoers. It's good to go to church, but a lot of people, I mean, I have people in my ministry and church that I've seen, Repentance is of the heart. Let me read Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5 to 6, and I'll round up. It says, let your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things as ye have. For he hath said, that is God said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. Oh my goodness, the creator of the universe. So there's nothing that you do that will make him leave you. That's where we get eternal security. Verse 6 of Hebrews chapter 13, it says, so that we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper, and I will not fear what man shall do unto me. When you get saved, the Holy Spirit, God's Spirit, God himself becomes your helper in any area of your life. All you need to do is have that change of heart. Repent and start from your mind, saying to yourself, I will change. I will stop listening to this stupid and foolish gospels that doesn't produce results, and I will do what God says. It starts from your heart. And you now say, God, help me. Holy Spirit, help me. Because he lives in you. But if you are not saved, you don't have the Holy Spirit. Satan will always lead you to the wrong path. The Bible said, the thief cometh not for to kill, to steal, and to destroy. But Jesus said, I have come. I came to give you life. That word life, the Greek word is Zoe, means eternal life. The God kind of life. He came to give it to you. And when you have Zoe, that means the Holy Spirit comes to live in you. And he's the one that will help you. If you refuse to receive the Holy Spirit into your life, you cannot have a repentant heart. The world system will teach you lies, and you believe a lie. But today, if you are not saved, come to God today. Come to Jesus. You see, the Lord is your helper. Nobody can help you. I, Pastor Ambrose, I cannot help you. Yes, I can assist you financially or advice. You see, your pastor cannot help you. Your bishop, your GO, your prophet, your archbishop, they cannot help you. It's only God himself, through the Holy Spirit, that can genuinely help you and never leave you nor forsake you. Some of you have been kicked out of your churches because you choose the truth. It's because they can never help you in the first place. I was kicked out many years ago when I started embracing the truth. It was a journey of walking in truth. You know, until you are kicked out or you walk out, you will not genuinely embrace the truth. You see, people will leave you, forsake you, use you and dump you, take advantage of you. But to God, no, God will not leave you or take advantage of you. So come to God today the right way. He will not reject you, no matter how bad your sins are, no matter the evils that you have committed. Repent and start from your heart saying, you know what? I want to embrace Jesus. I don't want to keep doing what I'm doing. It starts from your heart, you making that decision. He will not reject you, no matter how bad your sins are. Come to him today the right way. The right way is in the Bible. He is ready to always help you. I like that help. So right now, I have a helper. Doesn't matter how many people are against me. Doesn't matter how big the situation is. That is beyond me. I know one thing. I have a helper. This is what David saw. King David saw this. That's why he wrote Psalm 23. He said, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He didn't say his wife. He didn't say his assistants. He didn't even say the money that he has in his account is his helper. He said, the Lord, the creator of the universe. David was in the Old Testament. How much you that is living in the age of grace when God himself comes to help you? But he cannot come to help you if you don't have a repentant heart and embrace Jesus Christ. So come to God today. How do you get saved? I put salvation, I compress it together here. I call it the ABCs of salvation or the roadmap to salvation for the church age. This is the church age. This is the age of grace. What is the roadmap? Number A, know that you are a sinner and lost and you need help. If you don't recognize yourself as a sinner that you need help, then you will not have a repentant heart. Then B, hear the gospel. The gospel is in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 1 to 4. It's about the blood that Jesus shed. Jesus took your sins, your past, present, and future sins. Oh, marvelous. My goodness. That is beautiful. He took all your sins. By shedding his own blood, he died on that cross. He was buried. He raised himself from the dead. And now he's in heaven. He said, if you can put your faith alone on what he did on that cross, salvation is yours. He now have mercy on you. Wow. Then C, believe the gospel and turn to Jesus for salvation. Put your faith alone. D, put your faith alone on the blood Jesus shed on the cross. E, say it to God. Romans chapter 10 verse 9 says, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe your heart that God has raised from the dead, you shall be saved. Then D, you are now saved, sanctified, holy, righteous, and sealed. The nanosecond, the split second that you believe on Jesus by saying it to him, you are saved, sealed unto the day of redemption. So come to God today. Come to Jesus, get saved. Once you are saved, Holy Spirit begin to work on you. And as he walks in you, you're going to be having repentance every time as you walk with him. Because you've been walking in bad ways, now you want to walk in the right way. So you have to have a change of heart. So repentance is just a change of mind, and it starts with you. God is here to help you, and he will help you to perfect you. That is God's plans for your life. And as you're being perfected, a lot of your friends might leave you. Even your loved ones might walk out of your life. But hold on to God. He is the one that is your helper until the day of redemption. I trust that this short fellowship and video has been a blessing to you. I just want you to do me a favor. Just put your comment below, share, and let me know how you feel about this video. And also, remember that I always love you, but Jesus made it possible for you to have the Holy Spirit live inside of you, not a bird, not a dove, the Holy Spirit, a person, a divine being, to live in you that can speak to you and tell you the truth, even as we minister the gospel to you. So listen to the Holy Spirit. He lives in you if you are a believer. And if you are not a believer, come to God today the right way, and he'll come and live in you. And Jesus loves you most because he wants to show mercy unto you. So go ahead and share this video, put your comments, and I will see you again on my next video. God bless you. Bye-bye.